a joy to be here. Thank you, band, for blessing us and allowing us to enter into the throne. That's crazy, right? The throne room of God. You get to walk in there, right? That is crazy. That shouldn't happen. That should not happen, right? Who am I? Who are you? Who are you anyway? What nerve do you have, right? That's crazy. You know, I love you all equally. I really do. But there's just something missing in here tonight. Man, there's no Parview family here. That's just not, this church is not the same. Like, I'm sitting over there, and I'm trying to praise Jesus, and I'm thinking, where is Mary and Joseph and Pops? This is killing me. Does anyone know where they're at? Anyone? You're all naughty. You don't know where they're at. Someone needs to know where they're at. We got to find out where they're at. Make sure, we need to blow their phone up and find out where they're at. Make sure they're okay. Do you know where they're at, Jess? You have any idea? It's been like 8 years, and they're always here. How do you have church without Mary and Joseph, right? You can't talk about Jesus without Mary and Joseph. Golly, it's crazy. Anyway, well, I'm blessed to be here. I'm excited, and I'm excited about what Jesus is doing, and I'm excited to be here to worship him and to exalt him and to see all your beautiful faces out here, that you guys want to do the same thing. I want you to do me a favor. I want you to give God your full attention. I want you to grab a copy of God's Word. There's Bibles all over the place. If you brought one, that is incredible. That's good. That's best. You'll know your way around. You can navigate it because it's yours. If you don't have one, don't sell yourself short. Don't gyp yourself. Get your eyes on God's Word. There's lots of them across the room. There's blue ones in the seat backs and on the tables and everywhere. So go ahead and grab one of those things and do me a favor and turn to Luke chapter 8 and get your attention over to verse 22. That's kind of where we're going to start. And while you're turning there, I just want to tell you that I have been doing this for a while. And I love what I'm doing, but I'm really excited about this church right now. Let me see if I can frame this right. I want to say it the right way. I'm not so much excited about Revolution Church as I am about what Jesus is doing at Revolution Church. Does that make any sense at all? I'm really, really excited about it. We actually are open other days. We're actually here on other days. There's days that we're here gathered in this building, not Saturday and Sunday, but we want you to come on those days. But we're here on Wednesday nights. This is a group of people that have been coming on Wednesday nights, every single Wednesday. And then many of those people are also coming on every other Monday night for prayer. And I just want to tell you something, okay, if you're listening up. There's a group of people in this church that are extremely fired up about Jesus Christ. And I love that, right? Listen, those crazy people that are clapping, they're praying for you. If you're not clapping, they're praying for you that you'll be one of those clappers and screamers and crazy people. There's this thing that's going through the church, it's pumping through our veins now, where we're not here to meet with God's messenger. We're not here to meet with God's musicians. We're here to meet with God. That's why we come. And we're excited about meeting with him when we gather in this place, okay? And so we want you to be feeling that way. We want you to be, there's someone, I'm not going to throw the person under the bus because I don't want to embarrass anybody, but there's someone who comes every single Wednesday night, and this was her words. She said, when I come to church, I come in and I start, you know what? You know praying, when you pray, you know, you're like, oh, Heavenly Father, I beseech thee. You know, right? All that King James stuff, right? Okay, that's not the way she prays. No, she's like, no, God, I'm coming to church, and I'm going to hear from you, and I need something because I've had a hard week, and I'm not leaving until you talk to me. Like, that's anticipation, expectation, and that is awesome. And I can tell you right now that God has been faithful to answer that plea from her heart. And I want to encourage you, that's the way our church needs to be. No one in here is happy with the status quo. You know, going to church, singing a few hymns, listening to God yell for an hour or so, and then go home, like, and that's it. No. Listen, you have not plumbed the depths of God, and you never will. He's never ending. He's eternal. And there's so much more. And when you come to this place, there's so many other things you could do. But you chose to come here, and it is our desire that you walk out of here so changed and impacted because you met with the creator of the universe. That's what church should be. When you come, it should be life altering when you walk out of here, like, wow, there's a church in the Bible in Corinth. And they were having that kind of church. It wasn't just a few hymns, a couple Hail Marys, and go home. No, it was so incredible that when the strangers would walk in, the unbelievers would walk in, they'd go, whoa, what's up? Oh, God is here with you. That's what we want. We want people to walk in here and go, whoa, what's up? Something's going on. Like, what's with those people? Why are they, like, they have jobs, they have mortgages, they fight with their wife, their kids drive them crazy, and they're going, yay, and they're smiling. What's up? I want some of that. I want to be that kind of church. Anybody excited about that? I just want to be, that's the kind of church I want to be. So that's what we want to press in and do. And so we want to worship God and worship God well. And that's what we're all about. And so we've been trying to do that. We've been trying to accomplish that. We want to worship Jesus well. We want to worship him correctly. And Jesus tells us that real worship is in the balance of spirit and in truth. Like, there's an excitement about Jesus, like, and it's not capital S like the Holy Spirit. It's a small S. It's enthusiasm. It's emotions. It's feeling. And all these old, sorry, these old farts have been telling you that worship at church shouldn't be emotionally. Shouldn't tug on your emotions. Let me tell you a little information in case you don't know. Every emotion inside of you was given by God. And it's to be used for him. Everything that you are, your entire life, your body, your emotions, your thoughts, your feelings, your hands, your eyes, your ears, what is it that you have that you've not been given? And so we're supposed to use those things to give it back to the one who gave it. And so your emotions are part of it. So we should be fired up. Our spirit, it should be fired up, right? I shouldn't be the only fired up dude in here. Who else is fired up about Jesus, right? I'm fired up about Jesus. And so he wants us to be fired up, but he also, there's this balance of spirit and truth. We got to have some truth, right? We have to have some truth. And they kind of feed each other. Let me give you some examples. You don't have to turn there, but three things in Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5, there's three things that are said there. Well, why do we need truth? Well, one, because he said so. That's enough. We could drop the mic and go home. But if that's not enough for you, in Ephesians chapter 5, it says this. Imitate God, therefore, in everything you do. Follow the example of Christ. Carefully determine what pleases the Lord. Let me ask you a question. How are you supposed to imitate a God you don't know? How are you supposed to follow the example of Christ if you don't even know who Christ is or what he did? How do you determine what pleases the Lord unless the Lord tells you what pleases him? So we have to seek some truth because you can't worship him. You can't live the life that he wants you to live, like he says, to do what he does and imitate him if you don't know the truth of who he is. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18, it says, you must look at your neighbor and say, you must. Okay, how much? Yeah, you look at him. You must. How much wiggle room or how much leeway when God says you must, how much leeway is in there? Show me.
Zero.
Yeah, nothing, right? So here's something, this is a command, right? This isn't a suggestion. It's not you ought to do this, this would be fun. No, you must grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Like, I'm not here to change the word of God. I'll never do that. But let me just offer you something. Grace is not something you can conjure, right? It's something God gives. So would it be helpful to say this, to grow in the realization or to grow in the awareness of the grace that's been going on for quite some time? You know, there's grace going on all the time. He's been gracing you. Remember a couple days ago when you were breathing? Yeah, remember that? Remember before you were saved, how you ate? Remember when you took that shower back when you were six? And you hadn't been baptized yet? There's been grace going on for a long time. You need to raise your awareness of it, and you must do this. How do you do that? How do you determine what pleases the Lord? He wants you. He says you have to grow in your grace. Well, I can't grow in grace. He's the one who graces me, but I can grow in the awareness. How do I do that? I got to know who Jesus is. So that's why he says you must grow in the truth. How are you going to figure out, how are you going to find Jesus' fingerprint if you never researched it? How are you supposed to know where God is if he shows up? He's been showing up. Remember when you breathed? You didn't know it was God doing it for you, but that was him. You only know it by seeking out the truth and finding out he's the giver of life. You know that song we sing? It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, right? Yeah, I didn't know that. Really? I didn't know that was your breath in my lungs. I thought my diaphragm just moved by itself. I thought it was just like magical. God's going like this somehow. He's going like this. He's expanding your lungs. Why does your heart keep beating? Did you do that? Say, no, I did not. He did. If he says stop, guess what? It stops. He's in charge. We only know that by seeking the truth. We learn the truth. We need to get fired up about pursuing truth. We need to get fired up about daily reading the scriptures, daily studying God's word, memorizing God's word, meditating on God's word. That's what we need to get fired up about doing that, right? How many people got fired up and learned so much when they meditated on their one verse? Come on, right? That was awesome, right? And we have to get fired up about coming to church every week. I'm so sick and tired of seeing empty seats from people who say they're going to come all the time. Listen, if you want to get fired up about Jesus, you got to get fired up about his word. You want to know, like, I'm going to come and I'm going to hear God's word. How many people, you said you were fired up about the word you studied, right? How many of you were fired up when you heard everyone else's word that they studied? You guess what? Let me tell you something. Newsflash, you wouldn't have got that if you weren't here. That happens right here. It doesn't happen in your car. It doesn't happen at home. It happens right here at Revolution Church. And you're selling yourself short if you keep yourself here. You got to get fired up about coming over here, right? You got to get fired up. And when the truth is gained, you're going to get fired up even more. Listen, I don't want to worship some fake God. I don't want to expel. Listen, I'm so stinking tired all the time. I have no resources left. And I'm sure as heck don't want to expend any of my resources, my time, my thoughts, my I have none, but my money. I don't want to expend it on something that's not worthy of it, right? I want to spend it on something that's worthy. So if I'm going to get fired up about something, or in this case, of course, we're talking about someone, Jesus, it's got to be the real deal. It's got to be the real deal. So that's why we got to find out the truth of who he is. And I've said this so many times, I'll say it again. When the truth of who Jesus Christ is falls upon you, there's only one thing to do. It starts with a W, worship. When you know how awesome he is, you have to worship him. And I don't want to worship someone who's not awesome. Right? Stop using awesome for everything, by the way, too. I said that today. I was like, I said something about awesome. Like, really? That's not awesome. I don't even know what it was. Like, pizza or something. What is that, right? Pizza's not awesome. It doesn't instill, like, awe inside of me. Like, oh, my God, that pizza's amazing. It doesn't take my breath away. Pizza never walked on water. Never. Jesus did. So we have to stop calling stuff awesome that's not. Jesus is awesome. He's awesome. He took my place on the cross. That's amazing, right? That's amazing. We can talk about a lot of things. We could stop right now. That's enough. He took your place on the cross. Now, how can you not be fired up about that? How can you not? That's what we've been doing here for the last 6 months, is we're finding out the truth about who Jesus Christ is so we could worship him. And worship him well, and worship him correctly. And that's exactly what Luke was doing. That's why we chose this book. That's what Luke was doing when he wrote this letter to this guy that he called him Most Honorable Theophilus. That's what he called him. He wrote this letter to this one guy. And Luke says in his letter, when you start reading the letter, he says he's compiling a quote unquote, a careful account of Jesus. So that Theophilus, then of course by default now, because we've read it for you and I, so he writes this careful account so that you and I and Theophilus can be quote unquote certain of the truth. That's why he did this. There's a lot of opinions about Jesus Christ, right? He is the most popular person that's ever walked the face of this earth. He's on covers of magazines even now. Time Magazine, Life Magazine, always talking about Jesus. Everyone wants to talk about Jesus. You love him, you hate him, but you can't ignore him. He's the most popular person to ever walk the earth. And so we want to know who this Jesus is. And so there's a lot of rumor going on around about Jesus. And churches are filled with people that don't even know who he is. And they're worshiping something like Jesus said to the woman, that you worship something you don't even know. People in churches all over the world, people that are not in churches that claim to be Christians, they're worshiping a God they don't even know who he is. They've never taken a moment to spend any time with him, to research who he is in his word. They just listen to what grandma told them, and most of it's false and phony, and they don't have any idea because they're basing it on what they were told. Listen, you got to spend some time and get to know who Jesus is. You can't be worshiping some fake thing. If I was up here and said, look, it's Gumby, let's worship him. Some of you might say, oh, awesome, because you don't know. We got to know. We have to know some things, right? We got to know some things. And so this writer, he spent some time and writes this letter, this careful account, so we can be certain of the truth. We need to know who Jesus was. We need to know who Jesus, this is what people struggle with, who Jesus is. That's present. Who Jesus, what Jesus will do, what he actually taught, the real truth about who Jesus Christ is. And listen, no matter what we do, on the back wall, there's all these pictures of different message series that we've preached here and over the years. And those are all great and fine. You can watch them on YouTube. But at the beginning of anything, you got to get this. You got to get this. We need to know the truth of who Jesus Christ is before anything else. Before anything else. And so Luke and then two of the other gospel writers, Matthew and Mark, these are known as the Synoptic Gospels. They're very, very similar. They're three different authors, all to different audiences, but about the same man, Jesus Christ. But they all tell this one story, the story that I told you to look at when we first got started. It's in Luke chapter 8, starting in verse 22. And what this story does is it really begins to unpack the truth of who Jesus Christ is. You guys ready for some truth? We gotta have some truth in the place, right? Gotta have some truth. All right, I'm gonna read it with you. Read along with me. Does God have your attention? Your phones are off. Okay, Bible's open, pens in hand. Make some notes. Check it later. Don't just assume I've got a microphone. I might not know what I'm talking about. I hope that I am. I want to rightly divide the word, but you know, I'm not Jesus. I'll make some mistakes here and there. Open your Bible. One day, Jesus said to his disciples, let's cross to the other side of the lake. So they got into a boat and started out. As they sailed across, Jesus settled down for a nap. But soon a fierce storm came down on the lake. The boat was filling with water. King James would say it's full. And they were in real danger. The disciples went and woke him up, shouting, Master, Master, we're going to drown. When Jesus woke up, he rebuked the wind and the raging waves. Suddenly the storm stopped and all was calm. Then he asked them, where is your faith? The disciples were terrified and amazed. Who is this man? They asked each other. When he gives a command, even the wind and the waves obey him. Does anyone have a napkin? It's not a sermon prop. I got to blow my nose, man. I'm tired of sniffling. Is this it? It's not used, is it? Oh, you're the best. Thank you. It's straight from Starbucks. What did it cost you? $4.50? That's an awesome sound person right there. Props to Katie. That was awesome. See, if you could time it for every sniffle, that would even be more impressive. No one can do that. Awesome. Thank you, Jess. Thank you. I probably need that in the future, though. Yeah, hold on to that. Did I tell you that we're going to have everyone over the house later? Okay, so pause. So after church tonight, my wife and I would like to host all of you, if you'd like, to come over our house. It's cold out, right? We finally have winter. So we have a fire pit, and we're going to do it in the backyard. We got some wood. My wife made a taco soup. I think some others are bringing some food too. I don't know, but we're going to have hot dogs, s'mores, hot cocoa. I think Andy might bring a guitar so we could worship, you know, under the stars and stuff. So, like, when we get out of here, I'll get going. Okay, I'll get going so we can go. But if you don't know where we live, just follow somebody. Everyone knows just about. If you haven't been there yet, please come. Please come. All right, so just a couple things. So Luke chapter 8, we read that, right? Okay, so let's talk some facts about this story. Let's get some facts out of the way so we can get some framework on pursuing Jesus, the truth of who Jesus Christ is, okay? So this story takes place around the Sea of Galilee. It's this, if you're looking at Israel, even on a map now, it's this body of water kind of towards the northern part of the nation. It's very small. They call it the Sea of Galilee, but I would say it's more like a lake. Like, it's really not that large. It's like 7 miles across in one direction and like 12 to 14 miles in the other direction. Not a very big lake at all. It's where Jesus Christ did most of his ministry work. Like, all in just those 3 years or so that he was alive doing his thing. Most of that was done around that little area. In Luke chapter 9, it says, there's a turning point where it says that Jesus now sets his sights upon Jerusalem because his time was coming. His time is the time he's going to go to the cross. And so he knows that time is coming. It's been predetermined. He knows that's the plan. It's his Father's good plan to do that. He's willing to go do it. He knows he needs to turn his attention from where he's been ministering to go to Jerusalem and go to the cross for you. But before that happens, he's performing most of his stuff in that little area. That lake right there, the northern part of Israel, it serves also as a border between the Hebrew folks and the Gentiles that are on the other side. Okay? So most of Jesus' disciples, those ones that he called early, like if you're a Jesus follower right now, I don't know if you know this, but you're a disciple as well. Right, you're a disciple of Jesus Christ. You're a follower. You're a student. You're an imitator of Jesus Christ, right? But his early disciples, the guys he called to start his ministry, all these dudes in the Bible, most of them were fishermen by trade, and they actually worked that lake. That was their office right there on the lake. So they knew the lake really, really well. And they knew that almost every evening, because of the geography, because of the mount, see, if you go to the Sea of Galilee, it's 700 feet below sea level. It's very, very low at the water. But above it, all around the ridge, is all these mountains. And so all this cold air would, and it still does to this day, the cold air would come down off of the mountain and smack into the hot air coming off of the lake. And every evening, the winds pick up. And it's very, very common for it to get extremely windy out there. And it's very common that there would be an extreme storm in the evening. That's just what the lake did. And the fishermen would know that. It's also safe to assume, and let me walk you through this so you don't think, you know, I'm assuming something that we shouldn't. I think it's safe to assume that not only that the fishermen knew it, but I would say that Jesus knew it about the storms and the wind. And I would say that even that just the people that lived there did. And I say that because of this. How many people in here, in this room right now, are meteorologists? None. Okay, but we also, how many people have lived here in Central Florida for more than 5 years? Raise your hand. Okay, so you guys now know that in the summertime, it gets really, 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 really hot all day, and somewhere between 2 and 4, it's extremely common for the clouds to come in, for the lightning to start to strike, for the thunder to roll, and it's gonna get nasty out and start pouring somewhere between 2 and 4, most often. It's very common in the summer months here in Central Florida. Do you know that, right? Okay, so is it safe to assume that the people who lived around the area of the Sea of Galilee understood that this lake had a problem at night? And you wouldn't go out onto the lake in the evening. It's just not what you would do. Now, all three Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, tell the story. But Mark tells us what time of day it happened. He says in his gospel, as evening came, Jesus said, guys, let's get in the boat. So what's that mean? Like for us, 4, 5, 6 o'clock, right? As evening's coming, right? So it's an extremely odd thing for Jesus to be doing, to ask these guys. He lived up there. He knew the climate. I think he had the cards were kind of stacked too. He knew what was going on, but we'll talk about that in a minute. But he knew, and the fishermen knew, and everyone around them knew what was going to happen in the evening. Like, it says that there was other boats that followed. So there were people all around. And so here's a very weird thing that this Jesus, who's supposed to be this wise leader, teacher, would ask these guys to go on a suicide mission out on a lake where it was going to be storming. Unless, we're going to find out, he does everything on purpose. There was something to be done. He's not just some crazy guy on a, you know, an adrenaline junkie wanting to go out there and go bungee jumping off of a cliff. That's not what Jesus was doing. And we know that because we read on, because we've studied, right? We read. So why has he done this? Well, we're going to find out. I want to bring this to your attention too, something else as we're finding facts. What I'm about to share with you has absolutely, what I think, zero theological value. But I want to share this with you because I want you to, when you read the Bible, I want you to read it with fresh eyes. I don't want you to read it and assume what everyone else has taught you, including me. Okay? Most pastors are not going to tell you that. But I will. Don't just assume that what I teach you is the gospel. You have the gospel in your hand, okay? So I'm telling you, what I want to share something with you, just to tell you that when you read the scriptures, take time to examine what it says and dig out truth, okay? Now, I've been a Christian for almost 15 years now, and I listen to pastors all the time. I've been to churches galore. I've sat under a lot of people's teaching. Now, I've heard the story of Jesus in the boat with the storm and the calming of the storm many, many times. I've heard it taught several times. Anybody else? Okay, most of us. Okay. It is traditionally acknowledged, accepted, and taught that when Jesus went out on the boat, there's a certain type of boat that he went out on. I have a picture. I'd like for you to, could you bring that up for us? Okay, that is a boat that they brought up out of the Sea of Galilee, and they estimate that that thing's about 2,000 years old. And to this day, the boats that are used on the Sea of Galilee to go fishing are sort of like that. They're like 15 or so feet long. It's like a big canoe. Okay, it's like a big canoe. And that's what I've been taught. I've been taught that Jesus went out in one of those with his disciples, must have been crowded, and they went out onto the boat and they were going to cross the lake. That's what I've heard. And so as I began to study this in the weeks coming up to this, I started assuming that. So when I'm studying the scriptures, I hope you're visualizing what you're reading. Okay, that's what you need to do. You need to visualize what you're reading. Put yourself in the boat to get the full effect of what's going to be taught. So I assume that that was the boat. But I'm going to tell you, I strongly disagree. And I'm going to show you why. And this is only so that you will read the scriptures with fresh eyes. Don't just assume, okay? If you read all three accounts of this story, you're going to see that it says that it was such a violent storm that the waves were crashing over the boat. Now, how nasty is that? That's pretty rough, right? And so the waves are crashing over the boat, and it said that the boat was full. This Bible says it was beginning to fill. You go to King James, it says it was full. So now imagine this boat. The waves are crashing. Now, they're not just rippling onto the side. They're violently crashing over the boat, and the boat is filled with water. And what the teachers want you to believe is that Jesus is sleeping during that. It also says that when this was happening, they screamed out, "Master, Master," and they went to wake him. How much, just you guys look like a smart bunch. How much room is there for went? It also says that when they got into the boat, that they sailed across. You see a sail on that sucker? I don't either. I think we've been taught a big old fat lie. You need to read the Bible. And it, like I said, it's no value. It doesn't make any difference what kind of stinking boat it was in. But I'm just saying, when you read, this is what it means to meditate on the Word. This is what it means to study the Word, to pause and read that little story 60, 70, 100 times if you have to, and get something out of it. Don't just read and go, oh, that, man, that Jesus, that was incredible. Who is this guy anyway? Like, that's cool. And we're like so focused on the miracle, we miss the details. And this details all in Scripture will help us understand the truth of who Jesus is. You know what I'm all into? It is written. Yeah. That's what I'm into. I don't care what somebody taught me. I'll sink that stinking boat again. I don't care if it ever comes up. I want to know what's written. It says that they went. It must have been big. It must have been, it must have had a sail on it since it sailed. Right? You know, so I'm just saying, don't just assume what you read in the Bible. Like, don't just read it. Just read it. So there's some framework, some foundation, some setting for our pursuit of truth. So I'm going to give you three things, three truths about Jesus Christ that will certainly help you worship him correctly and well with some spirit. Get excited, right? Some spirit. And here's three things. In 451 AD, church leaders gathered at the Council of Chalcedon, which is in northern Turkey. If you looked at a map today, it would be northern Turkey. So these church leaders get together to kind of solidify the truths of our faith. Because there's a lot, like even so now, we've got a lot of different churches that believe different things, and this about Jesus and that about Jesus and all. So the church leaders get together and say, all right, listen, we need to kind of like affirm some truths so we could kind of pass it on, going, all right, here's the real deal. Here's what the Bible teaches about Jesus Christ. And we're all in agreement of this, right? And so one of the things that they decided and affirmed, and it's from the Scriptures, and of course from people that actually were there with him. So it's just a couple hundred years after that. So we've got some recent history, kind of like with us. Like, we think, well, 400 years later, I mean, that's crazy. I mean, we're over 200 years from the start of our country. We open up our textbooks in school and we believe what it says, right? So is this a stretch? It's not really a stretch, is it? If this country lasts another 200 years, you know, who knows? We're going to believe that George Washington was our first president. We're going to believe he had wooden teeth. We're going to believe in Abraham, that Abraham Lincoln was there, right? We're going to believe all that stuff. Declaration of Independence, Constitution, we got all that. We believe that, so we can believe this. It's pretty recent. So they get together. One of the things that they absolutely solidified as truth is this thing called the hypostatic nature of Jesus Christ. The hypostatic nature of Jesus Christ is this, is that somehow, some way, there's this person that has two distinct natures. That he is fully man and he is fully God. Now that's kind of weird, right? But that these two distinct natures converge into one person. And they affirm this at that council, that he is fully human being. He is fully man and he is fully God. I want to take you on that journey. So first thing is, of course, is that Jesus Christ is fully man, 100% human being. Prior to this little boat trip here that we see in our text, Jesus was healing lepers, and he was raising kids from the dead, and he was healing paralyzed people, and he actually, it says that he climbed up this mountain. This is where he preached the Sermon on the Mount. It said there was big crowds, right? Big crowds. Like, we don't know if that meant hundreds or maybe even thousands of people. I don't really know because the text doesn't really say specifically. But there was huge crowds. And it says the beginning of chapter 8 that Jesus began a tour. This guy was a rock star. He began a tour preaching in all the villages right around the Sea of Galilee. So he's going from place to place to place, preaching to huge crowds, healing people, casting out demons, raising people from the dead, right? Awesome work. Now, I got to tell you something. Like I said earlier, I'm exhausted. I have two kids that drive me crazy, and I've got all this here with you guys, and my work is exhausting too, right? It is. I'm tired. But listen, it's not nearly like what Jesus was. I have a car. I have a car, and I have a bed. I have a king size bed with two pillows. And I live, listen, like all of us, I live like 90% of my life in climate control. Jesus walked. He walked. And I'm not talking about $75 Nikes with memory foam in it. I'm talking about a slab of leather that was about as soft as this with leather straps over his feet on dirt through mountains and deserts, and he walked everywhere. And I don't know about you, but when I get done just preaching, like for an hour, I've got to do everything I can to get my energy back up for Sunday morning. He was doing it every day to thousands of people and casting out demons and raising dead dudes. He was tired. Jesus was tired. Some of us falsely view Jesus as like superhuman or some superhero. Well, he's not superhuman. He was a man just like me, just like you, just like everybody here, just a human being. He took a nap. He was tired, right? In John chapter 4, Jesus is speaking to the Samaritan woman at the well, and she asks him for a drink. He was thirsty. He's not superhuman. He was tired and he was thirsty. In Mark chapter 11, Jesus asks them for some food. He was hungry. And in John chapter 11, it's when his buddy Lazarus dies, Jesus cried. He was tired. He was thirsty. He was hungry. He was sad. And when he went to the cross, he bled and he died. He's a human being. He's just a man. That's who Jesus Christ is. He's not superhuman by any means. He was just a man, just like you and me. No different. He was a man of flesh and bones and blood with emotions and feelings and hunger and thirst. And he was tired and he went into the boat to take a nap. Christ's hypostatic nature is described with clarity in Philippians chapter 2. I would welcome you to please turn your Bible to Philippians chapter 2 and read this with me. While you're turning, I'm going to sip coffee. Are you there? Philippians 2, verse 6 and 7. You ready? Everyone, I still hear pages. I don't want to leave anybody. Good? Okay. A cat in the hat. See, you weren't reading. Busted. Though he was God, he did not. There you go. Super holy. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave, watch this, and was born as a human being. He was born as a human being. He was fully man. This Jesus was born as a human being. And this verse 6 speaks of Christ's other nature, his divinity, where it says, though he was God. So you see that there, you see how we transition from one nature right to the next, all converging into one person, Jesus Christ the Lord. So Jesus is fully God. I was speaking to a gentleman who used to come to this church every week. He's moved, so he can't be here anymore. He's moved out of state, actually. He called me the other day. And he's a guy who's, he's a good dude, really, but he's kind of confused about different faiths and religions because he has spent some time in his life exploring different world religions. I think that's kind of okay to do. Some people do that. I do not, because I couldn't give a flip what they do. I have one person I'd give my whole life to pursuing him, and it would take an entire lifetime to even get a smidgen of all who he is anyway. So what am I going to waste my time on other stuff for? Right? So that was a great place for an amen. But you don't have to. You don't have to. But if you did, I'd appreciate it. So I don't get paid much. I could take an amen, man.
Amen.
All right, cool. So he's talking to me about his life and what he's doing. And he's like, well, I do follow the, I keep trying to teach him, like, I teach him some stuff still, but he's like, well, I still follow the truths of Christianity, and I follow what Jesus teaches, and, you know, being compassionate and love your neighbor and do unto others as you want it to do unto you, you know, the golden rule and you know, feeding people and this and that. And that. He goes, well, I'm a true Christian. I really am. He's a Hindu, but he tries to follow Jesus' teachings, and he thinks that's what makes him a Christian too. And I'm like, does anyone see a problem with that? It can't be both. It's like, not a buffet. It's not a hybrid. You know, a little bit of both. I could do a little bit of this and a little bit of that. You know, throw in a little bit of Buddha and a little bit of Jesus. You know, I do this and then I do this at the same time. Maybe that'll work. Kind of hedging my bets. You can't do that, right? Jesus said, I'm the way. No one gets to the Father except through me. So I said to him, I said, yeah, that's not really true Christianity. See, that's not where you start. See, the jump-off point to true, authentic Christianity means you have to accept that Jesus Christ is God first. Because if you don't believe that Jesus Christ is God, then everything that he teaches is a farce. You wouldn't take a lesson from a corrupt dude, would you?
No.
I wouldn't. If you tell me what to do, but I know you're corrupt, I don't want to listen to anything you have to say. Right? So to be an authentic, true Christian, you have to believe that Jesus Christ is God first. That's the first bridge you got to cross. The rest of it will happen later, but that's the first bridge. But some, see, they focus too much on the person of Jesus Christ and his social graces of feeding people and healing and teaching morality and all that kind of stuff, and they forget the reason why we should even follow this guy. It's his divinity. It's his deity that makes him worth listening, right? I wouldn't listen to him if he, you know, he said that I and the Father are one. Okay, so if he's not God, why would you listen to anything he says, right? He's a phony and a fake if that's not true. So don't listen to him. So he's fully God, right? John chapter 1 starts out like this. You don't have to go there if you don't want to, but listen. John chapter 1, right at the beginning, in the beginning. I always get a kick out of this because people say, what's that? I don't even know. In the beginning. Before anything. I don't even know what year that was. That was like one. Right? So before anything, I guess. I don't even. Whatever you could think of is before that. And then it was before that. And before that. Okay, in the beginning was the Word. We don't know what that is yet. The Word was with God, okay. And the Word was God. And the Word gave life to everything. So before Jesus, and then the Word put on flesh and dwelt among us. So before he came that day in Bethlehem as the 6-pound, 10-ounce, come on now, right? Ricky Bobby baby. Before he came, he was already Jesus. Jesus wasn't made that day, right? He was already before that, existing as a life-giving spirit then. He's a life-giving spirit now, but between those times, he was here as a baby, and then he became a man. He grew up. The movie says so. Right. So, that was a funny one. That's a funny movie. But Jesus already was, right? He already was. And then he was born as a human. He already existed and then became a human. Hebrews chapter 1 verse 2 says, teaches us that God created the universe through his Son, Jesus Christ. Colossians 1:16 would say the same. So when you read the Psalms, it says that he spoke and the planets came out of his mouth. You know who was speaking? Jesus Christ the Lord. Not born yet, but existing already. He's the one who God used to speak the worlds into existence. When Genesis 1 talks about creation, let there be light, and there was light. Guess who said, let there be light? Jesus Christ said that. That was Jesus. He was God. He is God. Jesus was a man for sure. He was thirsty, he was hungry, he was tired, he napped. But before he became a man, before he became a baby in the manger, he was God. And that deity was not diminished in any way as a man. As a man. So as a man, when Jesus says, I and the Father are one, or if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, that's a legit statement. You can believe it, right? He was a man, but he was still God as a man. Two in one. People have trouble with this reality. So you, it's funny, you can, it's weird because in this country that was formed so we could talk about religion and politics, that's the two things everyone says don't talk about. That's stupid, by the way. Okay? So, like, don't fall for that stupidity. You talk religion and politics all you want. If they don't like it, they can go elsewhere. That's why we're here. If you don't like it, go back to England, dude. Right? I mean, right? That's why we started this country, right? So we could do those two things. It's just crazy. So you can, like, in this country, you know, the amount of atheism, it's like nothing. It's like a single digit percentage. It's like virtually nothing. They have a big mouth, but there's not many of them. Most people believe in some type of ethereal thing that's kind of, if you're a Christian or whatever, but if we're a Christian, we hope something a little bit more specific than that. But most people in our world think that there's, you know, especially in our country, they think that there's some type of ethereal God thing up there, you know, doing stuff, right? That there's a God. That there's a God. But when you start talking Jesus God, whoa, right? Then it gets kind of hairy. Then tempers start flaring and mouths start yelling and people start turning away and don't cram that down my throat. You start talking Jesus God, that's a real problem. But listen, the disciples struggled with that too. And I want to show you that. They struggled with that too. See, they've been following Jesus around and they're watching all these miracles, right? They're watching the miracles. They're listening to this authoritative preaching coming out of this man's mouth. But God? But God? Man, I don't really know about that God thing. It's kind of a stretch. See, if you notice something about the Bible, the people that were in the Bible and all that stuff, Old Testament, New, everything, everything was about God. I mean, that's what they did, right? None of this, you know, begging you to come on Saturday night at 6. Like, what do we got to do to get him here at 6? Like, there was none of that junk back then. We got to get back to making God important. You know what I'm saying? Like, you read the scriptures. They were told. Do you know in Acts chapter 2, it says that they met in church every day? Yeah. Right. They met in church every day, right? And as if that wasn't enough, then when they got done, they went to people's homes and they met more. Like we're going to do tonight? Right. Don't blow it off. Right. Right? Let's tick off the neighbors with worship music. Woo. Can we do that? Would you do me? They already hate me because I broke all the rules by mulching my whole yard. So let's sing to Jesus all night. That would be awesome. If I don't get a letter from the Homeowners Association, I'm going to think the night was an epic failure. So I don't even know what I was talking about. But oh yeah, so they met together every single day, right? In Acts chapter 3, listen to this. It said that these two guys, I think it was Peter and John, it says they were on their way to the 3 o'clock prayer time. Come on. The 3 o'clock prayer time? What is that all about? I'm begging people to come to church once a week to give them an hour and a half of Jesus. And they had three, I'm talking Wednesday at 3, Thursday at 3. That was just part of their life. Like, they knew how important it was. They loved God. They needed to worship God. They went to church at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. They must not have worked. Really? Listen, they worked. Right? Paul worked. I mean, he talked about that he worked harder than anybody else, not only to provide for himself, but to provide for everyone he was working with in the ministry. He worked. You think y'all worked? He worked. But guess what he did at 3 o'clock? Done. And he prayed. Man, God's stuff was important back then, Man, I wish I could turn back time a little bit. I don't want to go back to the good old days because I think they're yet to come. But I'd love to turn back to that where we had, man, I'd love to come in here at 3 o'clock and see, you know, a couple dozen of you show up every afternoon at 3 o'clock and we could play a little guitar and we could worship God for an hour or so. Man, that would rock. I'm just saying, I'm open to it if you guys want to do it. Just not, you know, I can't do it on this day, but I could do, making excuses, right? Y'all have keys, leave me alone. So listen, I say that because we're talking about that the disciples struggled with the deity of Jesus Christ too. These guys were all Jewish guys, right? And God was a big thing back then. There was 3 o'clock prayer time. People were meeting in houses and church every single day. Like, it was a big deal, right? So these Jewish guys, they definitely would have been familiar with the Old Testament Psalms, right? How about this one? Psalm 89:9. You, God, rule the oceans. You subdue their storm-tossed waves. And they certainly would have known about Job, right? Who in here is Jewish? Yeah, you wish. Grafted in, baby. He's a Jurican. That's what he is, right? He's a Jurican. Yes. It's my brother. I'm Jewish, and Michael's like legit. He's got Jewish in his blood too, right? So you guys aren't Jewish, but you've heard of Job, haven't you? Everybody's heard of Job. He's the guy, everything just was, it fell apart, right? Everything fell apart for the guy. Everyone knows that even now, but let me do this for you. These guys definitely would have known about Job, right? They were taught the scriptures. They were in church every single day. They went to church every day, and then they went to people's homes to learn even more and worship more. These people would have known, these fishermen on the Sea of Galilee would have known the story of Job. And in Job chapter 38, verse 8 through 11, look what it says. This is God speaking to Job, right? So we should listen. God's talking. He says, who kept the sea inside its boundaries as it burst from the womb and as I clothed it with clouds and wrapped it in thick darkness? For I locked it behind barred gates, limiting its shores. I said, this far and no further will you come. Here your proud waves must stop. Now, if you read that chapter, it doesn't just end with that. It goes on to say that God tells Job, hey, I'm in charge of the wind. I decide exactly which field gets rain and which one doesn't. I determine the exact path. Anyone ever seen any lightning? It says he's the one who determines the exact path of every single lightning bolt. That's God who does that. He's in charge of the snow. He's in charge of the rain, of the ice, of light. He's in charge of every single star. He placed it where it belongs, and he knows its name. He's the God in charge of all of the natural world. That's who God is. Now, they knew this. So when the storm comes to their boat, they run to Jesus. Master, Master, help. Well, perhaps they thought that Jesus would pray for them. Like Jonah, remember? Remember when Jonah's on his boat? He's rebelling from God, and God throws a storm at the boat, and the people are hedging their bets. They're like, I prayed to my God, and it's not working. Why don't you pray to your God, Jonah? Maybe the storm will stop. So maybe these guys, they thought that. Because Jonah was a prophet, and maybe they thought, well, this Jesus, he's a prophet. He'll pray to Jesus. He'll pray to the Father. He'll pray to God for us, and he'll save us. And you know what's really cool? Jesus does pray for us. It's true. He does pray for us. Hebrews 7:25 says, Jesus lives forever to intercede with God on our behalf. Romans 8:34 says that Jesus is pleading for us. One of the great things about this church as of late is I know that some of you are praying for me. And I love that. And I appreciate it. And it's working. But you know what I'm really fired up about? Jesus is praying for me. That's awesome, right? Jesus is praying for me. I'm kind of fired up about that, right? Jesus is praying for you, dude. He's praying for you right now. It says he lives forever. He's pleading for you right now. What's Jesus doing right now? Praying. No, you got to say it right. Praying for me. Praying for me. praying for me. Say it, you stubborn people. It's praying for me. That's awesome. The creator of heaven and earth stopped doing that, and now he's praying for you. That's awesome. That's the reality. That's the reality. But Jesus didn't pray for them. He didn't ask God the Father to save them and calm the storm. No, that's not what the story says. The story says that he rebuked the wind and the waves and all was calm. Is it a wonder why it says that they were amazed and absolutely terrified? Why? They weren't standing in the presence of a prophet. They were standing in the presence of the Creator. They were terrified. They didn't know what to do, right? And so that's why they said, who is this man? They had seen the miracles. They had listened to the authoritative preaching of God's word as if he was the author, because he was. And now they're seeing that this only God can do that, they're thinking. He's like, yeah, that's right, baby. Only God can do that. That's me. They were terrified of him. Fear of the Lord is good. This man rules the waters and subdues the storm-tossed waves. Colossians 2:9 says, for in Christ lives all the fullness of God in a human body. Yes. Listen, lives. Do you know what that means? Whether it was written, whether you read it back when Paul penned it, or you read it just now for the first time, it's written in the present tense. Christ lives, and all that God is, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, was living in this man who was in that boat on the Sea of Galilee. No divinity is diminished. Don't strip his divinity to conform him to your humanity. He is Jesus Christ the Lord, and he will not be diminished. Full, complete, entirety, lacking nothing and diminished in no way. The hypostatic nature of Jesus Christ makes him unique. There's only one like him. There's no one else like him. There's no one who will ever be like him. He is unique, fully man and fully God at one time. Still, now, alive. Here's the last thing I want to mention to you. I told you there's three things, right? Fully man, fully God. The third thing is that he's mission-minded. Jesus Christ is mission-minded. That's what he's thinking about. He's thinking about the mission. Do you know he had a mission? Do you know that before he came to earth, he was already God? We talked about that. We've established that, right? Long before the manger, long before the angel of the Lord, long before Mary and Joseph and all this stuff, before the there's no room at the inn, before the census, before all that, Jesus Christ existed in heaven as creator, in perfect relationship with his Father and the Holy Spirit, existing, three in one God, okay? So when he came to this earth, it was not to prove who he was. He doesn't need to. He is. He is God. So when he came, you have to know that there's got to be, if he's not here to prove himself, why would you come? There's got to be a reason. Why he would lower himself, like it says, take the humble position of a slave, go to the cross, endure the cross, disregarding its shame, be whipped and beaten and stripped naked and killed. Why would he do this? It's not to prove who he was. He doesn't need to. If none of us ever existed, he is God. So there's no reason to come to prove who he is. So why did he come? Luke 19:10 says what his mission is. Every church has a mission statement. Jesus has a mission statement. He said, I came to seek and save that which is lost. That's the only reason that he came to this earth. He didn't need to prove anything What he needed to do was save the ones he loves who can't save themselves. That's the only reason why he came. And so that's supported in this story. And let me tell you something. Jesus Christ, remember I told you last week when I shared my Bible verse with you that I didn't want to be a pastor that would ever tell you what to do and then not do it myself? I wouldn't want God to shake you down until he shook me down. Right? I don't want to be that guy. Nobody likes that guy. Nobody would like Jesus if he was that guy. And so Jesus would never tell you that you'd be his witnesses to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And he wouldn't tell you to go to all people and all nations and make disciples of them all if he wasn't willing to do the same thing. And this story shows right here that he will do exactly that. In chapter 8, verse 22, it says that Jesus got into the boat to cross the lake. And at the very end of the story, in 8:37, it says Jesus got back into the boat and returned back to the exact spot from which he came. And right between those two bookends is one situation. That's why he came. That's why he got in the boat. He's mission-minded. And so just to summarize, because it's kind of long, I don't want to keep you. But just to summarize it, Jesus gets into the boat and he crosses over from the, just sounds awful, but he crosses from the Jewish side and he goes over to the Gentile side. And we know that it's a Gentile side because it was a herd of pigs. And Jewish people, they were kosher. They didn't herd pigs. Okay? My mom's still that way. She keeps a kosher home. You're not allowed to eat any pig product. So they were swine and filthy and religiously unclean. Like, you didn't go anywhere near them. But there were herds of pigs there. You can read the story. Please do read the story. But he goes into the boat, and as he approaches the shore, this man who's been running around, who's a total lunatic filled with demons, and he's running around naked, cutting himself, screaming, scaring people. They try to lock him up. He busts the chains and he's running around, crazy person, in the cemetery. And Jesus Christ gets into the boat and he goes over there, casts the demon out of this man, completely heals him, gets back in the boat and goes back home. That's why he went. For one person, he's totally mission-minded. That's why, now we have clarity. That's why he told them, let's get into the boat. That makes no sense. He went into the boat to go get this one guy who needed saving. You know how depraved the world is? He went over there, and there's this man who's harassing and just disrupting the whole neighborhood. People are afraid of him. He's a freak. Like, would you make a movie about a guy like this, right? And Jesus heals him. And when the crowds show up, there's that guy who was a raving loon filled with demons, and he's sitting. Just like this. Next to Jesus. You'd think they'd be happy. It says that they begged Jesus to leave. That's the world we live in right now. Jesus is so sweet and good, and everyone thinks we're jerks because we try to push Jesus down their throat. They need him. And for some reason, this Jesus who's so amazing and beautiful and kind and gracious and compassionate, they don't want him. They didn't want him then either. Nothing changes. Nothing new under the sun, guys. It's the same world that we live in today. But that's why he went over there. For this one man. He goes into the boat, he crosses over, he does some ministering, he draws a crowd, and then boom, he's done. Blow in, blow up, blow out. That's what he did. One person saved. And then he says to the guy, no, go tell everybody. So he goes in, and he does nothing except heal this dude, and he says, hey, go make much of me. Go back and make much of me. That's why he was there. He's on mission. And listen, there's no other indication. When you read these accounts here in the scriptures, now I'm not saying that nothing else happened. I wasn't there. But what's in the scriptures, there's no other indication or no other reason why Jesus and his disciples got into that boat except that. That's it. He's mission-minded. He's always engaged. Is there anything in the scriptures? I don't know. I'm not the best student of the scriptures by any means, but can you guys ever remember anything in the scriptures where it just says, you know, we were just hanging out. We were just chilling. What did you do today, Jesus? Yeah, I just, you know, I took a sabbatical. Just took, kind of took a day off, you know. He was always doing something, wasn't he? He was on mission all the time. And let me ask you a question. What a Christ follower supposed to do? Follow Christ. So what does that mean for you? You're supposed to be always on, finish the sentence, mission. That's why you're alive. On mission for Jesus, to seek and save that which is lost. That's what your life is about. Can I get the band to come back up? Smooth transition right there, huh? I don't think we're ever going to be smooth, and that's cool. But what we are going to do is we're going to give you another opportunity to worship Jesus. Yeah. Okay?
Exalted.
And as they get ready, I just want to say this. Yeah. Jesus Christ, just to summarize it, okay? Listen up. Jesus Christ is fully man just like you. And he's fully God. When he came as a baby in the manger, as he was laying there wrapped up in his strips of cloth, he was God right then and there. And when he went into the boat and he ministered to this legion, this guy, this crazy loon in the cemetery, he was 100% God in that moment too. And when he went to the cross to pay for your sin, and when he died as a man, in that very moment, he was 100% God as well. His divinity never diminished. And because of that, he's always on mission to go out to everybody, listen up, to all of us, and to redirect our faith. That's why he came. Because as men and women in this world, we put our faith in other things. Like the fishermen, they would put their faith in a boat, right? They would put their faith in the lake with the fish to provide. We would put our faith in what? In our job. Some of us will put our faith in our spouse or our children, or heaven forbid, in me or your church. We'll put our faith in our favorite sports team, right? We'll put our faith in a political party. We'll put our faith in the nation that we live in. And we put our faith in a lot of different things, don't we? But what Jesus says here is this. Guys, where's your faith? I mean, that's the whole story here in the boat. The storms are crashing. Where's your faith? Where do you put your trust? It's not, where is it? He wasn't going, hey, where is it? No, he's saying, where is it located? And so that's the mission of Jesus Christ, is to refocus you, to shift your faith from anything else to the one thing that is secure and solid that you should put your faith in. Him. That's it. He wants you to make much of him and then let all the other things that we would put our faith in begin to diminish.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
That's it.
Amen.
That's what he wants to do. And so I just want to ask you this one question. Where's your faith? Where's your faith? What is it that you put your trust and hope for a better tomorrow? Where is it? Is it on him and him alone? Or is, unfortunately, Jesus sharing that throne with other things? If you'd like to dethrone those things, you can do that by a choice of your will right now. And just say yes to Jesus Christ and Christ alone. That's where my faith is. If you'd like to say yes to that, you could do that right now. We would celebrate with you. I know I would. I would hug your neck and be so happy to call you brother or sister. That'd be awesome. And that's all you got to do is like, we're a Bible church. So you don't have to close your eyes. I was about to say, you got to close your eyes. You got to pray. No, you don't have to do that. You just got to tell him, because he's alive, right? Tell him right now, Jesus, and this, if it's true, if it's here, Jesus, you have exclusive rights to the throne of my faith. Amen. That's all you got to do. If you mean it, he knows it. Amen. He'll sit on it. Amen. Right?
Yes.
If you want to do that, you can do it right now. And start a real, authentic, genuine, this could be awesome, right? Relationship. Amen. With the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Okay? Amen. And then after that happens, if you want to make that decision, you want to start being obedient, we can get you baptized right now if you want. We can do that. I'm ready. We got towels over there. We got water. You got a bathroom. You can get changed. We're spoiled people. But then after that, you can just start digging in, right? Just start digging in. Start digging in. And as you dig in, the things that are on that throne, they start falling off. And he starts increasing. Increase, increase, increase. The Lord of your life. The Lord of your life. Awesome, right? That's awesome. So I want to pray with you. If you want to make Jesus your exclusive, you could do that. We could pray for you and we could celebrate that. If you want to talk to me about it afterwards, we could do that. I know that I'm gonna be up front. We could talk there. I know Robert, one of our elders here, he's going to be behind this wall right here. Him and his wife will be back there probably. And if you want to just talk or pray, if you have anything you want to pray about, anything you want to share, anything that's on your heart that's heavy, you just want to release it to someone that would love you, you could do that as well. We can just pray. All right? All right, let's pray for a moment. Then we're gonna worship him. You guys want to worship him?
Yes.
You want to sing Exalted Over All?
Yes.
Yeah, I want to sing that too, because he is. Lord, there is only one name that's above all names. There's only one name under heaven that we could call on to be saved, and that is Jesus Christ. So Lord, for those of us that have stolen and deprived you of exclusivity on the throne of our faith, we repent. I repent right now. I repent personally. I repent before us all and before you. I repent. There are things on my throne that don't belong there. And so, Lord, I don't want to be like that anymore. I really seriously want to be saved, Lord. That's what I want. I want 100% salvation right now, like 100% exclusivity. That's my heart's desire. I want 100% exclusivity on the throne of my faith to be owned by Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. And I know I'm not alone. I know many of us in this room feel that same way. We want to do that, Lord. Help us. Begin to purge the things. Kick those things off the throne, Lord. Kick them to the curb where they belong and take your rightful place. We want to exercise that new belief right now, Lord, before you, in your presence, while you're here with us. We want to exalt you and put you on the throne right now. As my brother Andy said, you inhabit the praises of your people. You are enthroned upon the praises of your people. As we sing to you, Lord, we are putting you on your rightful place. The name above all names, the exalted one, Jesus Christ the Lord. We love you, Lord. We thank you for this night. Thank you for this place. I thank you for all these people. Help us to worship you well right now. In Jesus' name, amen.